يا ذا الأسماء الحسنى يا خالقنا غفرانا نسألك وأنت الأسمى نأمل عفوك سبحانا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We've got today the name of Al-Bari. Al-Bari is from one of the Asma'ullah al-Husna, وَاللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْخَالِقُ وَاللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ الْمَلِكُ الْقُدُّوسُ السَّلَامُ الْمُؤْمِنُ الْمُهَيْمِنُ الْعَزِيزُ الْجَبَّارُ الْمُتَكَبِّرُ الْخَالِقُ الْبَارِ. Now Bari, as we explained last time, Bari is a name that is more specific than the name of Al-Khaliq. Al-Khaliq is something that is quite common in terms of Allah creating something which hasn't even come into wujud, existence. And it also means that Allah has made a blueprint of it without anything preceding it. Al-Bari is a name that shows that Allah has already planned this and He is now making it come into wujud, into its existence, and He is now executing His plan. According to how He was going to make His creation, He has made His creation. Now, there is no one that can be called Bari because Allah Azza wa Jalla is the only one that can have this name Bari. And one of the things that Bari has, one of the meanings of Bari, is that it can come from Bara, which means that Allah has created this from the earth. So where Allah has used that in the Quran is in Surah Bayyina, which is the 98th Surah of the Quran, ayah number 7. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ. Surely those people who have believed and who have done good actions, they are the best of the creation that Allah has created. They are the best of those who are on the earth. Meaning that they have been created by Allah Azza wa Jal from the earth, and Allah has made them the best creation on the earth. And in the same surah, Allah Azza wa Jal, He says that those of them who have not done well, who are the mushrikeen or who are the polytheists, they are shabul bariya, the worst of those who have been created from the earth. So that's one of the meanings if it's from bara. Otherwise, from the name bari is a name that shows that He is the creator and He executes His plan after He has actually made the design, and He will make it come to existence. Now, one of the things that this name has, one of the features of this name, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He has created this individual, before He has created the individual, He would have already planned for it some things that would come within the life of this creation. So in Surah Al-Hadid, which is the 57th Surah of the Quran, ayah number 22, Allah says, مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا. There is no affliction, whether it's in the earth, whether it's within yourselves, except that it's already in the book before we have created it, before we have created this. Now, what does نَبْرَأَهَا refer back to? What does this refer back to? If you look in this ayah in Surah Hadid, ayah number 22, you'll see that musiba is feminine. It's a feminine word, musiba, with a ta marbuta at the end. The word ard is also feminine, and the word anfus is also feminine. So there's three words here that are feminine. And when Allah Azza wa Jal has said that He has created an affliction, this affliction will befall someone, but before the affliction actually befalls someone, it will befall them
before Allah has even created the earth, before He has created the souls, or before He has even created the musibah. Now, if they have the dhamir or the pronoun in nabra'aha in this ayah, if this is referring to the musibah, to the actual affliction itself, then it means that before Allah even has created the affliction, He has destined where it's going to befall. And the second meaning is before He created the earth, He has destined where exactly this affliction will befall. The third is before He has created these individuals in the soul, it is very clear where this musibah, this misfortune will befall. So according to this ayah, Nabra'aha, which comes from Allah's name Bari, means that Allah not only creates, He not only creates, for example, the creation of human beings, but He also creates, for example, the earth, and He also creates non-tangible things like a musibah or an affliction. So Allah Azza wa Jalla creates the affliction too. Now, in the Holy Quran, you will find that Allah has sometimes used other words, but He refers to them as a creation after He has made the blueprint. These ayahs can be found in the Quran, for example, Surah Anbiya, which is the 17th Surah, ayah number 30, Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. From water we have made everything come alive. From water we made everything come alive. So now, the water itself. Before Allah even created any water, before that even time came that He created the water, He was Al-Khaliq, He was the creator. When He brought the water into existence, when He was bringing it into existence, He was Al-Bari. This is known as Allah being the creator, being Al-Bari. And Him making other things come into existence because of that water, because that water is going to make other things come alive, this is also from the name Al-Bari. When Allah has said, Inni khaliqun basharan min teen, this is Surah Sa'd, ayah number 71. He has said that I will create a human being or human beings from molded clay. When Allah has said that, that means that Allah Azza wa Jalla, here He's the Khaliq, because He has not yet created that. However, He has said in the Holy Quran that in various ayats of the Holy Quran that He has created the human being. Now look at this verse, for example, in Surah Mu'minun, ayah number 12 to ayah number 14. Surah Mu'minun is the 23rd surah of the Holy Quran. First Allah says, خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ سُلَالَةٍ مِنْ طِينٍ. Allah says that I have created the human being from the clay itself. Then later on, or the molded clay. Then later on, He says, "Umma ja'annahu nutfatan fi qararin makin." And then after that, I will settle this human being within the womb itself. Then Allah says, "Khalaqna nutfata 'alaqatan." Allah says that I will create the semen, I will move it, I will make something else out of it, I will make it a clinging thing. And then from there I will make it mudwa, I will make it a different item, and each time it will grow. Now all these things, before Allah has done these things, Allah is Al-Khaliq, He is the one who is the creator. When he has made it come into existence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Bari. Now what does this all mean? This all means that Allah Azza wa Jal, He has the ability to bring things into existence. And since He has the ability to do that, if one of us wants something from Allah Azza wa Jal, of something to be created, for example, somebody wants to see if they can get a son or a child, it is only Allah Azza wa Jal that can give that son, it is only Allah Azza wa Jal that can give that child. There is no one, absolutely no one, that can give a child without Allah Azza wa Jal having His insha, or having His irada, or having His will for that thing to come into existence. Now how people's aqa'id or their beliefs get corrupted. For example, if I give you an example. If you have If you have a person who goes to the idols, and the person starts to pull the idols and says, give me this, give me that, oh idol, give me this, give me that. How the aqaid gets corrupted is that over time, Allah is always giving to everyone according to his sifa of Rahman. He's a Rahman. So out of him being Rahman, he will give everyone. Now after 3 years, he's already ordained that this person will have a child. That person now is an idol worshipper. So that person comes to the idol, he worships the idol, year number one, he gets nothing. He carries on worshiping the idol, year number two, he gets nothing. He carries on worshiping the idol, year number three, and suddenly he gets a child. Now, Allah did not give this person the child because he worshipped the idol, no. Allah gave this person the child because Allah is Rahman. Allah is Rahman. It doesn't matter what color you are, doesn't matter what race you are, doesn't matter what religion you are, doesn't matter what faith you are, doesn't matter whether you believe in Allah or not believe in Allah. He will give certain people fortunes and he will give certain people misfortunes, and these are not according to religion. These are not according to religion. Otherwise, if all Allah's blessings was according to his, according to our religion, what this would mean is that Allah Azza wa Jal would have had to give the most religious people the most of the fortune of this world, and the irreligious people, people who are not religious, Allah should have given them nothing on this earth. But Allah hasn't done that. So what happens is that the person who worships the idol, after 3 years he gets his child and he says, oh, for 3 years I've been worshipping this idol. So that's why I got the child. See, the idol gave me the child. And therefore they go off the path. Therefore they are not believers in Allah. And Allah did not do that because they worship the idol. Allah did that because Allah is Rahman. He gives whoever he wants. And he will always give whoever. Before they were created, Allah already ordained, I'm going to give you this many children in this many years, I'm going to give you that. So now when you have Muslims, there are certain Muslims, they go to certain graves and they start asking for certain things. They might go to the grave of Abu Khatib Jilani, they might go to the grave of Sayyidina Ali, they might go to the grave of, you know, Piran Pir, Bakhsh, and I don't know how many names there are of these different people, Khwaja Muinuddin in India, Shah Jalal, Rahimahullah's grave in Bangladesh. They will go there and they will ask. They will ask the deceased, they will say, I want a son. So I'm asking you to give me a son, or to pray for me to get a son, and all of these things. These are things that are not allowed in Islam. These are not things that are allowed. Because Allah Azza wa Jal has given permission to us to talk to him and to call him directly, and Allah has given us an order to do that. So that means that when somebody wants something to come into existence, we don't talk to any other individual, whether they are dead or alive. We talk to Allah Azza wa Jal directly and we get what we want from him. Because there is absolutely no one who can give anything at all, whether it's in this world or in the next world, whether it's something we see or we don't see, there is no one who can give us anything except for Allah Azza wa Jal. So that is the name of Allah, Al-Bari. Now we come to a name of Allah Azza wa Jal, the next name, which is Al-Musawwir. Al-Musawwir. Now Al-Musawwir, the next name, if you go through the names again, هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر الخالق الباري المصور. So this name of Allah Azza wa Jal, Al-Musawwir, appears in Surah Al-Hashr, the 59th Surah of the Holy Quran, ayah number 24, it appears there. And also in Surah Ali Imran, the third Surah of the Holy Quran, ayah number 6, Allah has said, هو الذي يصوركم في الأرحام كيف يشاء. He is the one that fashions you within the wombs of your mother, within the wombs. Allah fashions within the wombs. Now, subhanAllah al-Azim, if you actually think about it, from a liquid that has no substance, Allah gives bones. That is, if you think about it, Allah makes hard skull, makes hard bones, makes a hard body out of a small unwanted liquid, which is in form of semen. So once that's in the mother's womb, the whole process of it to get to the taswir, which is what? Which is that Allah fashions every single part. If you think about it, the minute details of Allah planning every single vein, you know how small that vein is, how small the cells are within the body when it's being formed in the mother's womb. That is a miracle that we almost can see every single day when babies are born. It is Allah's miracle that He creates that from such a minute thing. And He creates hard substance from soft substance. And that is Allah doing Yusawwiruk. Now, Yusawwiruk means that He'll fashion the entire body exactly where the eye is supposed to be, the hollowness of where the eye is supposed to go inside, where the cheek is supposed to come out, Allah will bring it out. Allah will fashion the cheeks, and He will fashion the chin and so on, fashion the actual eyes itself, and the hands, the bone, the thumb itself, the exact pores where Allah is going to make the hairs come out of, all of that is fashioned. Now, so what are you sawwir? Taswir. Taswir means to give a 3D form to something which is there as a substance. Now the same thing is there in terms of if a person was to take a piece of clay or take something and they were to mold a statue out of that. And if they fashion the statue and they make the eyes of the statue, the nose of the statue and so on. If somebody does that, because there were people in the lives of the Anbiya, the lives of the Prophets that have done this. So for example, in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, there were people who used to fashion these idols. In Sayyidina Ibrahim alaihi wasallam's time, there was people who used to do that. In fact, Ibrahim alaihi wasallam's father used to do that himself. Now to fashion these idols and to make them, to create them, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said very clearly in several ahadith that ashaddu nasi adhaban yawm al-qiyamah. The people who will be given the most severest of punishment, the people who will be given that on the day of judgment, they will be the musawwirun. They will be the people who have fashioned these idols. Now, this is one of the meanings of musawwirun, that they fashioned them. What this means is that they made idols, they made others believe that these are real things that can give benefit, that can save people from harm. And when people worship them, obviously it was only stone. So on the day of judgment, Allah will bring these idols. There's an ayah in Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah says that I will bring up their idols they used to worship. I will bring them up. And in a hadith he says, Allah will say, in various hadiths in Sahih Muslim and so on, Allah will say, now you lot who used to worship these idols, blow into these idols and make them come alive. And if they can't blow into them and make them come alive, then the severest of punishment will come over those people who used to worship them. Now, there's various hadith. One of the hadith, for example, in Bukhari, hadith number 5950, in Muslim 2109, you will find that Allah Azza wa Jal, His Messenger has said that this punishment will be for these people. In fact, in one hadith in Tirmidhi, it says, يَخْرُجْ عُنُقٌ مِنَ النَّارِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ لَهُ عَيْنَانِ تُبْصِرَانِ وَأُذُنَانِ تَسْمَعَانِ. The fire itself, Jahannam, will bring out its neck. It will have two eyes with which it sees. It will have two ears with which it listens. And it will have a tongue. وَلِسَانٌ يَمْتِقْ يَقُولُ. With its tongue, it will start speaking. This is Jahannam that has taken its neck out of itself. It will say, إِنِّي وُكِلْتُ بِثَلَاثٍ. I have been ordered to consume three different types of people. Number one, بِكُلِّ جَبَّارٍ عَنِيدٍ. with anyone who's been a tyrant and who's been very stubborn, a stubborn, tyrant person, I've been ordered to consume that person into hellfire. Number two, وَبِكُلِّ مَنْ دَعَى مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرٍ. Anyone who has called a deity or one who is not worthy of worship, called anyone other than Allah Azza wa Jalla, they worship them or made them worthy of worship, I have been ordered to suck them, suck them within myself, within hellfire. And the third is بِالْمُصَوِّرِ, those who used to do taswir, who used to fashion others and make their eyes and face and so on and make them into idols. Now, the ulama have had ikhtilaf, they have had a difference of opinion within this hadith. Is it only talking about the fashioning of these idols, or is it also talking about photography? There's been a big debate amongst the scholars of this word musawwirin in several of these ahadith. And they've been divided over many different, ever since the camera photography has come out, they've been divided over this, which one does it actually refer to? They're all convinced that it refers to the idols and fashioning of the idols, but some others, especially ulama of the eastern side, okay, of the eastern region, they felt also that some of them, not all of them, some of them have felt that even the camera and taking pictures and so on is involved in this. Many others believe that that is not the case, but this is something which they have a right to differ over. Obviously, I believe that it's only something which is 3D, so if you fashion something which is 3D and make a mold out of it, that is something that you shouldn't do. But if it's 2D and if it's something, again, you've got to, my own opinion is, and this is according to many ulama's speeches and the opinions that I've heard of, which is that every hukum or every command of Allah will have a illah. Illah means it will have a reason behind it. Now, since in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, you find that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, there was his people, some of his people used to fashion idols, and this was one thing he had said in front of those people who used to create this. Then it shows clearly that that is the reason. Why? Because it's going to lead to shirk. It's going to lead to people worshipping other deities, other gods besides Allah Azza wa Jalla. So that's why that is one reason. Second is, like for example, once Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to his household and he found that Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, she had sewed into the door that he had a veil across it, and that veil, Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, she had sewed inside it the taswir, or you could say the surah, or the form of a bird. So she had sold that as a design in that. When Rasulullah saw that, he said, who did that? And then Sayyidatuna Aisha said, well, I did that. And then Prophet engaged in his salah. When he engaged in his salah, after he had finished his salah, he said, bring that curtain down, it has distracted me in my salah. So he ordered her to cut it into pieces, and then the cloth that remained, he said, make some pillowcases out of it. So she cut through the actual bird image itself, and then she made the covers of the cushions in the house. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed that. Again, the ulama will say that the reason why was because it was a distraction to his salah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and therefore he ordered for this to take place. Now, these are different ulama. Now, others have said, no, Allah Azza wa Jal, because he is musawwir, he is the only one that can create anything, whether it's 2D or 3D. Now, he has said, Allah has said in the Holy Quran, وَصَوَّرَكُمْ فَأَحْسَنَ صُوَرَكُمْ, that Allah has fashioned you and He is the best of fashioners, best of those who create any types of fashion of images of faces or things that have ruh, things that have a spirit. Surah Ghafir, the 14th surah, ayah number 64, this is the ayah there, that Allah has created and He is the best of those who create. So therefore, no one else should try and create like Allah. Now, does that mean that you shouldn't even draw a picture of a person that is alive or something that has got a soul? This is where they both sort of differed in this sense. Some ulama have said that, and this is some ulama, first of all, have said for educational purposes it is fine to have them in books and other things, and others have not agreed to that. Others have rejected that idea. They've said that for any purpose it is not right for them to have that. And the hadith that says where Allah Azza wa Jalla will tell them to bring them alive, this hadith is in Ahmad in Bukhari, Muslim Bukhari, hadith number 5951, hadith number 2108 in Muslim, where لِلَّذِينَ أَقَالَ الَّذِينَ يَصْنَعُونَ السُّوَرْ يُعَذَّبُونَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُقَالَ لَهُمْ أَحْيُ مَا خَلَقْنَا. That this hadith says they created or they made certain things that were images. What does that actually mean? Whether it's paintings, drawings, or whether it's 3D, it is again not so clear, but that is the hadith that refers to that. So in this sense, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He is Al-Musawwir, and it means that we have a belief that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He creates different images. Now within that, what that means is, as makhluq of Allah, as creation of Allah, we should recognize every face, every image, every single nose, every eyes that have been created. Who is the creator of those eyes? Allah Azza wa Jalla. Creator of the nose, Allah Azza wa Jalla. So if you see someone's nose, their nose is really big. Really big nose. On a small face. Now, when you look at something which is strange, and you look at it once and you think, well, this is a strange something, normally it makes people sort of laugh. It will make people laugh, but it's not right to laugh. It is not right to laugh. Anything strange you see, it makes you look at it and you might sort of start to find it amusing, or you might find something which is strange, and therefore some people might even mock at it, some people might laugh at it, but it is wrong. So if somebody finds ears that are large, eyes that are large, larger than the rest, you know, how it should normally be on the face, or sometimes eyes are really small, the nose is really small, the ears are really small, or the teeth are really small. Some people have that. Some people have large teeth, some people have a large neck. All of this is from who? From Al-Musawwir, from the one who has fashioned them. And however he has fashioned them, he has done that. Now there's some people, I'll be honest with you, you know, like some people, they find it amusing to look at people and mock at them and say, well, you know, he's so skinny. And others might look at others and say, he's so fat. Yeah? Allah has fashioned us and He has fashioned our digestive system. There are some people who eat. They eat and they're eating little. They're eating just a little bit. But Allah has given them a slow digestive system. So it automatically gives them a large stomach or a large body, because the food doesn't process or doesn't go down so quick. There's others, skinny people, who eat twice or three times as much, but they never put weight on. This is who's doing it. This is Al-Musawwir, or this is Al-Khaliq, this is the one who has, or Al-Muqaddir, the one who has preordained for them how they should be. Allah Azza wa Jalla has done that for them. So we should not look at others and mock them. This is one test from Allah. One test from Allah. Because Allah has said in the Holy Quran, Surah Zukhruf, that you could take somebody else who is different from you, or who is lower than you in status, and you could start ending up mocking them. But Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, He's told us very, very clearly, not to mock them. Now, one other thing, again, with this taswir that I just said. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith, he has said that إِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ لَا تَدْخُلُ بَيْتًا فِيهِ سُورَةً. The angels of Allah, they do not enter a house where there is going to be a surah, there is going to be an image of something that is living, but there is a picture or something of it. Now, does that mean that it again refers to the 2D? Pictures, or does it refer to the 3D items or models and so on? Does it refer to that? There is a debate amongst the scholars over this. And again, they all have the right to differ with one another. Some have said even if it's 2D, they will not enter. And others have said no, unless it's 3D. So what does that mean? That means that if it's in a shape of a model and it's got images of a face and so on, that's when the angels of Rahmah, the angels of mercy, will not enter that house or that place. But others are different, because Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, she had a kind of thing that was like a doll, and she brought it to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's place, and she used to play with it. But then the other ulama have said that that doll never had any images or any facial sort of tasweer, or the face wasn't actually fashioned out. So the other scholars have said that. So therefore, there is this debate between the scholars, and it will remain as a debate. What did it actually refer to when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Ashadun Nas, the severest of punishment will be for those people who have created tasweer, or who will make or fashion faces? Which people did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam talk about? There is this thing that will be a debate for some time to come. Perhaps even until the Day of Judgment, it will be a debate that might continue, whether one is accepted or the other is accepted. Allah alam, which one Allah Azza wa Jalla has meant, or His Messenger has meant in that hadith. Now we've come to Al-Musawwir. Can we say the names again from Wallahu Alladhi? Wallahu Alladhi La Ilaha Illa Huwa Rahmanu Rahimul Malikul Quddusus Salamul Mu'minul Muhaiminul Azizul Jabbarul متكبر خالق بارئ مصور أو صاحب مصور الغفار. After مصور is الغفار, which is the one who loves to forgive. And with غفار there is a very close another name, which is غفور. Allah Azza wa Jal is غفور, which is oft forgiving, and غفار is in the form of it being mubalagha. Mubalagha means that Allah is putting it into an extreme sort of version of Arabic, which means that Allah really loves to forgive His servants. Really loves to forgive His servants. What we're going to do, inshallah, if you bear with me, inshallah, what we're going to do is, with the following week, we will continue with Al-Ghaffar, and we've got the name Al-Qahhar, and so on. There's, at the beginning of this book, there are a few debates. There are a few parts here that I covered some of, and other parts I haven't actually covered with you. One of the debates about the Asma'ullah al-Husna is which one of the names is part of His actual nature, and which one of them is as just a characteristic. So there are certain names, some of the ulama have said, for example, Allah is Hayy, this is part of Him, ever living, is part of Him. And there are others that are His sifat, that he will show a part of what He does with His creation, but it's not necessarily an essential part of Allah Azza wa Jal. And they have divided these into certain names that would be part of Him and not others. Again, it's a debate that I don't really wish you to go deep into, so I'm not going to cover that. Now, one other thing that is important is that Allah Azza wa Jal, His names are not confined within these 99. There are many other names that Allah Azza wa Jal has. Many other names Allah has that are outside of these 99 that are mentioned in the Quran. For example, Dhul Ma'arij, the one of great sort of heights. In Surah Ma'arij, the 17th Surah of the Holy Quran, you will find that Allah has mentioned His name as Dhul Ma'arij. Wa idallahi dhil ma'arij. Allah has said that in Surah Ma'arij. So He has got that name. But Allah Azza wa Jal, that name hasn't been mentioned in 99 names. And for example, it says in the Holy Quran, Surah Luqman, 31st Surah, ayah number 27, وَلَوْ أَنَّمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٌ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. If you were to get the seven oceans that you got, if you were to turn them into ink, and if you were to take all the trees of the entire earth, and you were to make pens out of them, which you would dip into this ink, okay? So you make small pens out of all the trees of the entire earth, and you make ink out of all the oceans of the entire earth, and you sit there, take a pen, and you basically dip it into the ink, and you start writing. You're writing what? You start writing about Allah and His names and His attributes and His wonders. You start writing about His names and the things that He has. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says that مَا لَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. He says His names, you cannot ever come to the end of His names or His words or His praise. Whatever it is, you will not be able to come to the end of that. The seven oceans of ink will finish. And the pens will also be finished. In a hadith, it says, in another part of the Quran, Surah Kahf, that is the 18th surah, ayah number 109. Allah says, قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ مِدَادًا لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي لَنَفِدَ الْبَحْرُ قَبْلَ أَن تَنْفَدَ كَلِمَاتُ رَبِّي وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا. Allah says, after the seven oceans finish, Allah says that if I bring you another seven oceans similar to that, and you use that also to try and praise me, you will not be able to come to the end of my praise, except that your oceans of ink, whatever you had, would be dry and finished, but my kalimat, my words, my praise, all that would not have finished. Thus, Allah Azza wa Jalla, his names are plenty, His names are plenty, and He is so great that we cannot encompass just a few words to describe Allah Azza wa Jalla. So do not think that the 99 names are only the only name, because there will be many other names that ulama have mentioned. In fact, it actually goes more than 200. The names of Allah Azza wa Jalla, more than 200 if you collect them from ahadith and if you collect them from the ayats of the Quran, the names of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Okay, we're going to stop here for today, and inshallah inshallah next week, be here 7:30, we will continue with the name of Ghaffar and Al-Qahhar, inshallah, we will continue with those names. Jazakumullah khair wa akhir da'wana.